Hey folks, welcome back to the channel and welcome to a brand new arc in our Winter Anime 2020 saga, and that arc is gonna be called the I Don't Feel Good arc. Yeah, if you can't tell, I finally got sick. It wouldn't be winter without me getting sick at some point, and I got sick right off the friggin' bat this year, so lucky me. But regardless of how I'm feeling, that doesn't matter, because there is anime that needs talking about, good folks that need entertaining, and an algorithm that must be appeased. So here I am, sick as a dog, but here to talk to you guys about ID Invaded, both episodes, episodes 1 and 2. But before we begin, I would like to let you all know that if you would like to have your name shouted out in next week's ID Invaded video, then be sure to share this video around on the internet, and then tag me at JojoTalksTooMuch over on Twitter, and I will be sure to shout your name out in next week's video, and hopefully by next week I don't sound dead. That'd be nice. Alrighty, so ID Invaded episodes 1 and 2. I gotta say, normally this whole two-part episode thing has been kind of getting on my nerves. I'm sort of sick of seeing it now. I don't know if maybe it's just my grumpy self saying that because I'm sick, or if I genuinely just don't like seeing that anymore, but at this point, I'm getting tired of the episode that's like double length, but really it's just two episodes back to back. But in this case, considering that both episodes 1 and 2 were part of the Jigsawed like little two-parter, I have no issue with it. Honestly, if anything, I think that this series really benefits from having a two-parter as like smashing together episodes 1 and 2 together, since this whole mini story is able to actually be complete between the two episodes. I do think that maybe some people would have kind of dismissed it having not seen the second episode, so having the two episodes put together actually does make a lot of sense. So I am behind Studio Naz's decision on that front. And yes, this is coming to us from Studio Naz, which is a bit of a surprise. The only other shows I am aware of from Naz are Dramatical Murder and Hajimete no Gal, which didn't exactly instill a whole lot of confidence in me. But you know what did instill a lot of confidence in me? That would be the director, A. Aoki, the man responsible for Fate Zero, Recreators, and Aldenoa Zero Season 1. We'll pretend like Season 2 doesn't exist. The director of all those projects is also coming on board ID Invaded as the director of this project. And it is coming to us from Otaro Maijo, who I don't know, but is writing this, I believe this original series. They have written Dragon Dentist and the George Joestar series of novels. I haven't read or seen them, but I just thought it was worth mentioning. Well, why'd you feel like bringing it up if you haven't experienced either story, JoJo?
I will tell you, audience.
The reason why is because Dragon Dentist sounds weird and the George Joestar novel is part of JoJo's bizarre adventure, and this first episode, or I guess these first two episodes, are friggin' bizarre, weird as hell, and kind of awesome at the same time. And by kind of awesome, I mean very, very awesome. Studio Naz absolutely crushed the visuals. I was so impressed with the way the series looked and moved, and the idea of the world itself being this sort of kind of like Mementos from P5 almost. It's kind of hard to explain. The way the first setting looks, the first well that we experience, and yes, they're called wells, the first well that we dive into is this broken world where everything's like messed up and weird looking. And even our main character, Saikato, he's awoken and he's in pieces. And I'm not gonna lie to you guys, the visuals are so good that I wasn't sure if the visuals were just really friggin' fantastic or if I just was so sick that I was experiencing a fever dream of some kind, because genuinely there was points where I was watching this and my slightly sick lightheadedness that I almost wanted to look away. There's like when Saikato dives, quote unquote, into the well and experiences what the killer views the world as, like that sort of digital landscape that he jumps into. The jump into that world, the crazy visuals, the almost like visualizer-esque type of look it has, kind of made, like, in fairness, I'm lightheaded and I'm not feeling great, but I actually had to look away because it was a little too trippy. And the way Saikato, our MC, is introduced to us is him literally coming apart at the seams, like pieces of him are just falling apart, and he screams because he's panicked. At first I thought he was in pain, but it's really just the fact that he's confused, like, why am I falling apart? What the hell's going on? but he's still able to manipulate the different parts of him that he can see. Like, he's still able to actually, like, manipulate those parts of his arms even though they're not attached anymore. It was really freaking cool to watch. And once we actually get to the second half of the episode, all the visuals start to make sense. And that's the other thing that I have to give this show, is that while the settings are definitely leaning more into the fantastic, like the strange and bizarre type of setting, it actually does tie into what is happening, and it's not just window dressing. It actually does remind me a lot of Mementos, like I said, from P5, and I don't think that I'm going to be the only person making that comparison. I haven't seen any other reviews for ID Invaded, so I don't know if that's a common comparison, but that's what it reminded me of. And the way it ties into everything, the fact that we see our character coming apart at the seams, right? He's like, and he's just missing a parts of him, especially in his arm. And we find out towards the end of the episode why that is. I think that's really interesting. I like this because when I was thinking back on it in retrospect, if you really were paying super close attention to what is going on in terms of the visuals, you actually could piece together why the killer is doing what he's doing. It's because the way he sees this world, since the well is his intent to kill and the way he sees things, you see that he notices that these people are like missing parts, right? So he sees them as missing an essential part of themselves, and he feels like he can complete that by drilling into their heads. It's intense, and it's definitely a very violent series because of it, but it's not necessarily gory. You don't necessarily see anything too grotesque. We do get a pretty intense scene with Hondo Machi at the a little bit past the midway point, but it just cemented that character as awesome to me. That's the rookie character. She was awesome in this first episode, and that's the other thing I gotta say, is I had anticipated only really being interested in Saikato when I first saw the PV way back a couple weeks ago, and I'm happy to say that I was pleasantly surprised that we actually do learn quite a bit about the other members of the team. We don't get to know them necessarily as intimately as we do Saikato and Hondo Machi, since they seem to be the two characters who I assume will get the most focus, since this is the premiere and they're the two characters that got the most focus in the premiere. And Hondo Machi in particular, her bravery in that moment where she's tied up and the killer's trying to get information on what the device she found was, which also gave me not P5 vibes, but Psycho Pass vibes. It kind of reminded me of Psycho Pass a little bit. Hondo Machi basically gets her intent to kill via suicide, which enables them to open up a well so that they can sort of get an idea of where her head is at, and they're actually able to piece together where she would be based on her mindset at the time. It's trippy and weird, but it also shows that these worlds aren't all going to look like broken up pieces. Like, they're all going to be reflective of the individual killer or people with intent to kill, like, their minds. When they dive in, it's not always going to look the same. And again, it's one of the reasons why I feel like this two-parter had to be a two-parter, and they had to be shown back-to-back, because it really settles you into the fact that not every world is going to look as trippy and interesting. I shouldn't say interesting, because that makes it seem like the other world wasn't interesting. But it's just the idea that not all worlds are going to look like these, like, pieced together Lego bricks of a world, right? For example, Hondo Machi's world is basically this, like, wasteland. And you see the Karu, I believe her name is, the character who's just, like, dead in every world she appears in. And you see her hanging on a tree. And then you see drills ascending from the heavens, piercing into the ground, basically reflecting her own Hondo Machi's mindset at the time of her intent to kill. And in this case, it was in her intent to kill herself, because she very well could have killed herself in that moment if she wasn't careful, if she went too far with the drill. Because, yeah, she basically jumps into this drill to get them that information, which really cemented her as a badass, in my opinion. And I don't know if you guys know this about me, but I love a good mystery, especially a locked room mystery. That's some classic stuff right there. And while we don't necessarily get a locked room mystery, we do get sort of an allusion to the fact that there may or may not be a locked room mystery. And trying to put the pieces of the puzzle together, which is actually a very apt saying now that I think about what happens in this week's episode, but trying to put the pieces together along with Saikato is part of the fun of the episode, because you're trying to understand why the world works the way it does, and that will actually help you better understand why the killer is doing what they're doing and why they have this intent to kill. And they're basically using this technology to not only better understand the killer in question, but also to get their identity, since it's, you don't necessarily need to know their information, just have the intent to kill. I'm not super sure how it works, but I do think I'm interested enough both in the setup of the mystery as well as the setup of the world itself that I want to learn more about this. I want to know how it is that they can hold on to the intent to kill from a mystery killer but not need to know their name, since the whole point of using the well is to try to figure out their name and their location, which I do think is really cool. And I think the world itself is really fascinating, like the technology behind it, the setup of the different cops, all that stuff really blends together in this really neat way, and I'm very curious to see how it all plays out, because I will definitely be sticking with this show. And I do think that this show will garner a decent following. Maybe I'm wrong, but I do feel like, considering the director and just how off-the-wall crazy the show is, I'm expecting this to be relatively popular. And honestly, if anything was going to be popular, I'm glad it's this. An original anime, so we don't necessarily know where it's going, but we do have a basic idea of how the world works already. I think the way that they establish their world building is subtle without like being too vague. And I don't know, I really like the world building a lot. I really like the characters. Again, we don't really get to know as much about the other cast as much as we get to know Saikato and Hondamachi, as well as Hondamachi's partner, whose name is escaping me at the moment, unfortunately. I'm also very curious to learn what's up with Saikato, as well as what's up with John Walker. Another big thing that they did well in this episode is tease some breadcrumbs for things to come down the pipeline, as Saikato is clearly some sort of killer, since they mentioned that only people who are a little bit off their rocker and who have actually killed before can usually survive the dive into the well, which means Saikato has definitely killed before. And if I had to guess, I would assume that Saikato's kid was either his kid or his wife was murdered, and he took revenge by killing the killer, perhaps? I'm not super sure, but it does look that way. Likewise, the mystery of John Walker is also very interesting. This sort of, this fancy-looking dude who basically appears in many serial killers' wells, and they assumed that he was just a sort of a manifestation of most serial killers, since apparently Kotaru shows up in most people's worlds. But they have realized that the way that the people in the room reacted to him with fear probably means that John Walker is in fact a real person with the ability to impress themselves onto people's wells or IDs or whatever the term is, but basically impress himself so much onto that person that he then shows up in their well. The setup for the world is friggin' cool, is what I'm trying to say, and I am very, very curious to learn more. I would like to talk a little bit more about it, but I am sniffling like you wouldn't believe. Hopefully I've edited all those out, but I have to end the video here, guys. I'm sorry that it wasn't as long as normal, but yeah, I'm really not feeling that great. But thankfully, I did have a pretty friggin' rad show to watch while I'm not feeling too good. So thank you, ID Invaded, for making me feel better for a solid 45 minutes. On that note, everybody, I'm gonna go ahead and give ID Invaded a pretty strong rank of A. I really enjoyed this premiere. I know I've been giving out a lot of A's, but typically with premieres, the show is bringing their A game. Ha ha ha. But they really are bringing their very best, and I feel the same goes for ID Invaded. I feel like this is a really, really solid introduction to this world and these characters, and I'm really excited to learn more about them. And that's gonna do it for today's video, everybody, so I hope you guys enjoyed. And before we go, as always, I have to give a big, big thank you to the good folks over on Patreon, especially those in the Earl Grey tier: Andrew W, Calvin A, Crowbar of Irony, Daniel G, Digger the Fox, Dominic G, Ionos, Urza, Ginkotaku, Godzilla Fan, No For Nothing, Maria Teresa, Marshall B, Mirth Mouser, Cell, Shadow Creative, Sipco Games, Somastan, Steven G, Sakochi, Tristan G, and Verdon. A huge thank you to all of you in the T Squadron for your continued support, and if you too would like to join the T Squadron, then be sure to check out the first link in the description to check out our Patreon page, see all the cool rewards you can get over there, as well as access to our Patreon exclusive Discord for as little as $1 a month. And with that said, we're gonna wrap up today's video, everybody, so thank you all once again for watching, and if you are feeling stressed out today, then you go have yourself a warm cup of tea, and I will talk to you all again real soon.